sign of his priestly office, and also his blue prayer book at the front, which contains the Psalms and the readings of Holy Scripture and the Fathers of the Church, which are part of the ordained minister's duty as he carries out his responsibilities on behalf of the Church. So let's say that it's some worn out books after the long life of prayer. I want to begin today to sit down for a moment because I want to take your words now.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Every high priest has been taken out of mankind and is appointed to act for us in our relations with God, to offer gifts and sacrifice for sins. And so, if he can sympathize with those who are ignorant or uncertain, because he too lives in the limitations of weakness. That is why he has to make sin offerings for himself, as well as for the people. No one takes this honor on himself, but each one is called by God, as Aaron was. Nor did Christ give himself the glory of becoming high priest, but he had it from the one who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have become your father." And in another text, "You are a priest of the order of Melchizedek and forever." The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Gospel passage we just heard is often referred to as the Beatitudes and also known as the Sermon on the Mount. It's sometimes looked upon as Jesus' alternative to Moses' Ten Commandments. It wasn't. They weren't to replace the commandments, they were to complement them. Jesus was teaching his disciples that by living our lives in a certain way, we will reap the reward in heaven. He set out for them the importance of living by much to so many people. Some of you know him as John, or Father John, or UJ, that's Uncle John, or Curly, or Iron Man, and his favourite name is Gilly. Scouts is always a great name. I'm going to use the name Gilly as I write, because that's what I call him. I'm going to share with you my memories of the priest, the man, and the friend that he was to people in his life. The numbers here today would have had him gobsmacked. For non-scousers, that's amazed. Being in dead shot. Translation, delighted. That was all right. So where did Gilly fit in your life? A brother? Uncle? Other relative? Friend? Parish priest? Archbishop? Or any other, as the survey would suggest? Today I want to remind you about Gilly the priest and Gilly the man. First, the priest. His priesthood was the most important thing in his life. He had a simple prayer life, saying his daily offertory prayers and celebrating Mass each day. Gilly was a pastoral priest. He thrived being with and among people. Pope Francis would have loved him because he smelled of the sheep. He was alongside his people. He was a high king of priests. He was one of us. No airs or graces, no looking for power, control, prestige, titles, or mere importance. His parishioners grew to understand that they should work together, share and use their talents, and get people involved, both the young and the old. He believed that this is how communities grow and progress. He was not a lover of administration work or meetings, but he was efficient and organised in both his departments. Although Helen, the head teacher, did try to suggest that he should go on holiday when Ofsted came in. We tried to end meetings early and tell them what waste of time certain things were. Always spoke his mind. Not always tactfully. With parish funds, he was financially shrewd. Not a penny was wasted on non-essentials. But he was not mean or tight-fisted. At St. Peter's, the church, house development and garden are testament to that. He didn't hog the garden privately. He shared it with the parish for barbecues, neighbour sessions, family birthdays, after mass tea and coffee, bonfire night, etc. He always played to do the best pastoral work at these functions. He would go around with a beer or a whiskey and sit and chat at tables. Afterwards, we'd often say things like, I've got to help sort out 3 marriages, baptise 2 babies, and hear a confession next week. And one person wants to become a Catholic. He met the people where they were. He sat amongst them. He loved preparing special liturgies, including the Passover meal for the Christian ministers. And let's not forget the memorial garden and the Easter garden in church each year. He was meticulous in preparation. His argument was why have liturgy if it's not meaningful? It's got to be meaningful to the people attending. It had to be relevant, challenging, and enjoyable. Services were for the people, not the clergy, he would say. He had an eye for detail. Sometimes he was irritated because of this, but it was always for practical services, Christmas and Easter services especially, were so popular that you had to come half an hour early to get a seat, just like last night and today. They were full of prayer, music, challenge, symbolism, reflection, and involved as many people as possible, again, the young and the old. Especially the children and young people. He always involved them as soloists, readers, musicians, and let them into drama and dance at times to express their faith. Mind you, he did make mistakes. The funniest was when he wished everyone a hearty Happy Christmas. Unfortunately, this is the Sunday. He never had a shortage of altar servers. Boys. He didn't want girls or serviettes, as he called them. He wasn't sexist. He just simply said, if we bring the girls in, the lads will leave. They will take over. It's in their nature. He inherited girls instantly to the point he grew to love them. Gildea was one of our chaplains on the first youth pilgrimage to Lourdes in 1975. He travelled on the coach of young people, and he did so for many, many years. He was very popular with young people, many of their grandparents. He was a big asset to youth service. Gildea will celebrate the 60th anniversary of the priesthood next year. Very sad to know him. He loved being a priest, and he once wrote, in every parish I found wonderful people, and I've enjoyed every minute of my priesthood. You will notice that the priests are all wearing white chapels today, white for the joyous resurrection. Gildea wanted a white funeral. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. And anyone who believes in me will have eternal life. This was the basis of Gildea's strong faith. No doubt about that. The message was so important to him. Anyone who believes in me will have eternal life. That is the whole point and purpose of the gift of life that God gave us. Now, Gildea the man. Gildea was a one-off. He was a man with a strong social conscience. Not publicly, but he was always powerful in any discussion group. In his St. Matthew's days, he formed a dynamic young Christian workers group, many of whom were still in touch with him. Deep down, he was a loving and very generous man. Not many people knew this, but every month he wrote several checks to charities. Mary's Guilds, Aids to the Church in Need, HCPT, Sally Army, Medical Mission, Mouth and Foot Artists, and not forgetting Louise's Holiday Fund. He never told anyone about them. I only found out because in the last couple of years I had to write his checks out for him. He was a talented DIY man. He won't be in heaven just yet. He was fixing a broken lock on the pearly gates of heaven. Or maybe painting the outside fence. Or busy changing the oil on Peter's motorbike. He never bought anything new, until after checking it was totally unrepairable. After his stroke, over 4 years ago, he got very frustrated because he couldn't work with his hands. But he never gave up. He was tenacious and determined. He attempted 29 jobs, often took him 2 hours. It broke my heart watching the struggle. He had a great sense of humour and loved an argument. His especially the whiskey deep into the night. He was a great sportsman, winning the Sackies at the age of 70. Sorry, 12. He was a good golfer, although his favourite quote was, "I hate this game." He was an accomplished skier and taught men to ski. Less than 12 months after his stroke, he was skiing down a 300 metre slope in the Alps. He was a good footballer, a Billy Lennon, he told me, a hard tackle midfielder. He always played footy with kids. On playgrounds and running teams with them in the parish. His passion was motorbikes. Riding around the parish, taking communion to the sick parishioners, giving kids rides, camping holidays through France and Spain with his much-loved sister Janet. He was noted as a very cool priest because of his 1000cc BFW bike. Lord, we know it was his time to go home to you. Look after him for us. He likes porridge, lamb chops and mushy peas. And I've emailed up my verbal grade recipe. Oh, and don't worry, he'll load the dishwasher. Gilly is my best friend and soulmate for over 50 years. I will miss him so much. I thank God he came into my life, but you all know the saying, behind every great man is an amazed woman. That was me. And lucky for him, there were a few of us. He claimed he was a better priest because he had women in his life as friends. Women who could put it straight on female issues. I can still hear him though. What? The hood was broken again. Women so heavy-handed, he shouted. No one dared tell him that three of the cleaners were men. Gilly, I know you are busy skiing clouds or playing golf with Fathers Brendan Rice. Kelly again. But here's a message from us. I hope you can find a few minutes to stop and look around here in this church. And you will see all the lives you have touched, brought closer to God and made better. His legacy was Christ's message that we should all try to live a simple life. Full of Christian love and compassion for each other. Be generous in our time and give money to those in need. Be humble in our roles of work. I pray in his memory that we keep our faith, try to spread it, and then through belief in the resurrection, we will all meet up with him again. We know where. Thank God we don't know where. I was with him when he died. What a privilege. I held his hand till he very gently breathed his last breath. I now understand the phrase, he died peacefully. He died where he wanted, in his own bed, and not on a corridor on his own in a hospital. His last words to me when I said that help was coming were, wait for it, shave me. Typical. Our last big laugh together. You don't really know the mess I made in his face. The last words I said to him was, I love you. I said on behalf of all of us who loved him. The most popular message that I received this week are, he was a wonderful priest and a wonderful man. One of the best quotes I heard was,
Thank you.
In him the hope of blessed resurrection is born. Let those saddened by the certainty of dying, rightly consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, we are faithful, Lord. Life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them. So with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, and without end we obey.
Your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Peter. Peter, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence, we rely upon faith and help.
In the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. We please to confirm in faith and charity your throne, Judge on earth. With your servant Francis, our Pope, Malcolm, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops and all the clergy, your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
Remember your servant John, your priest, whom you have called today from this world to yourself. From the he who was united with your Son and has left life in his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. When he from the earth, he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our holy body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who have been secure that are simply this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be mighty for all the ages, and praise you without end. Christ our Lord, to whom you bestow the world, all that is good.
having received the sacrament of salvation, we implore your kindness, O God, for John, our brother, your servant and friend in peace, that as you made him steward of your mysteries on earth, so you may bring him to be nourished by the truth and reality as unveiled in heaven. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Merciful